Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, a daily, early Buddhist contemplation. As long as this life lasts, I hereby take refuge in the Buddha. I hereby take refuge in the Dhamma. I hereby take refuge in the Sangha. I hereby seek shelter in the Buddha for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Dhamma for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Sangha for the second time. I hereby request protection from the Buddha for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Dhamma for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Sangha for the third time. The three refuges is hereby taken. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all killing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all stealing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all sexual abuse. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all dishonesty. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all alcohol and drugs. As long as this life lasts. From now on, I can hereby rightly consider myself to be a true Buddhist with the blessed Buddha as my teacher. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 63. And we are back on track with early Buddhism after a long but necessary and relevant digression into fundamental physics. Today are three also very relevant, all too relevant probably, questions about sex, drugs and rock and roll, basically. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you. The first question goes like this. It's part come up in several instances before. It's question 188, so we are tracking towards 200 questions answered. Now, it's not too bad. We're indoor because it's very rainy, as you know from the press. There's floods on Sri Lanka, around 200 dead. Is sex an addiction for sense pleasure? Is masturbation compulsive behavior? Can orgasm be advantageous? Three questions. We start first. Is sex addiction? Is sex an addiction to sense pleasure? And the answer is a sounding yes, it is. Just like eating is an addiction to sense pleasure, and seeing films and porn, and hearing music, and seeing beautiful nature scenes, and similar things. Just to measure, seeing cinema movies, teledramas, and so on. It's addiction to sense pleasure. And sense pleasure is the pleasure arised, just to stay with the definition, by eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, skin contact, or mental contact with the corresponding objects, namely visible form and color, smells, tastes, sounds, touches, and mental states, pleasurable mental states or agreeable mental states, such as orgasm or intoxicated mental states in particular, but all mental states actually. Addiction to that is addiction to sense pleasure. That's basically what runs the world. It's because it is so addictive, so tantalizing, so captivating, so dreamlike, so felt as needed, then this compulsive behavior of repetitive seeking the same sense pleasure as you got last time, and ideally the highest sense pleasure you ever have experienced in samsara, seeking this back to this very same sense pleasure again and again. This is addiction to sense pleasure. This basically runs the world. It runs all consumerism, which is choking the world as a natural nature system on which we ourselves depend, because we are depending on plants and trees that they produce oxygen and remove our carbon dioxide. Otherwise, we cannot breathe. And if human beings cannot breathe, then they're out in a few seconds. Huh? So this consumerism is threatening the biological organism called Gaia, which is all biological life on planet Earth at the moment, because of all this burning off of billions of years of fossil fuel pumped up from the underground in form of gas, natural gas and oil, which runs the transport industry. Basically. And then all advertisement, and thereby also all production, manufacturing of all kinds of items, from food to iPhones, everything in between. This is run by only one thing, sense pleasure. And on the other hand, this is the addictive part of it. If you don't get it, if the being that feels a compulsive urge, an obligatory need that need to be fed like an animal in a cage. If this person doesn't get it, then he or she becomes very aggressive. And so the Buddha said that all fights, kings among kings, politicians among politicians, father with son, mother with daughter, friend with friend, animal with animal, among all beings, they're basically fighting about sense pleasure, the access to sense pleasure. So this sense pleasure that seems so innocent, that you feed yourself with it every day, several times a day, this is basically running the planet down, one, biologically, because of pollution, two, is causing all conflicts, war and killings. A high price to pay, but beings basically are willing to pay anything for this sense pleasure, anything, including their own life. So the urge for sense pleasure in the untamed mind, in the monkey mind, goes before self-preservation, the need for preserving own life and own existence. It goes before that. So it says something about the hierarchy. Here is your wanting to live, but here is the felt need for sense pleasure. It's a higher one, because people give up their life for it. Most clearly in the example of injecting drug users, but also alcoholic addicts, and addicts to whatever kind of sense pleasure, overeating, obesity, smoking cigarettes, large killers. We'll come to this by the question about psychedelics later on. But nevertheless, so sex is clearly addiction. It is caused by usually eye contact or skin contact around the lips or the hands with the erogenity zones, which you see here, which are a little difficult, little different from man to woman, but basically the same. It's the genitals and particularly the mouth and the neck, and the breast, of course, and the buttocks, both for men and women, and the breast for the female. A little different whether it's caused by masturbation or not. But it drives the whole porn industry, which is larger now than the entertainment industry in general. So this is because of mirror neurons, was discovered 20 years back. If you feed one monkey that is hooked up to a click apparatus in his pleasure neurons, then the neighbor monkey also starts clicking. So this means that if you see somebody having sex, then one by these mirror neurons that mirrors the pleasure that you're seeing with one sense, it mirrors all the pleasure coming from the other senses also, because of a phenomenon called synesthesia. That you can get pleasure by seeing something, you can get pleasure on the skin without having skin touch. And therefore it is so addictive. So addictive. But of course not without a price. The prices can be from hell all the way down to hell, because let's say you are addicted to sex and then one has to seek up prostitutes and then having a sexual disease that eventually causes death, like HIV infection, and then giving transmitting this HIV infection knowingly because of not using protection and not using a condom, not using rubber, then it counts as not deliberate murder, but manslaughter. And repeated manslaughter over many repeated manslaughters or attempts to manslaughters, if transmission doesn't occur, over a long life, that is something that leads unambiguously to the barbecue. Unless one severely compensates for it by doing severely good over a long time period to compensate, to balance out this evil. So again, it's sense pleasure that drives the individual down by being careless and by being neglecting, even though the person knows when they have contact with the prostitute that there's a risk for transmission of sexual disease. They could use protection, but they don't, because they want to maximize their pleasure. And thereby, they run the risk of transmission of a sexual disease that caused death. And thereby, the cashier counts. The barbecue cash account. Then you earn yourself a ticket. Huh? So that's dangerous, of course. That's in the very disadvantageous, akusala, detrimental case of sexual behavior, seeking sense pleasure, and then joined with carelessness and neglect, and joined with a sexual transmissible disease that caused death. So it's a maximum negative. Can it be positive also? For example, there's this question about, can orgasm be advantageous? And I thought about there's some moment about orgasm that in the orgasm, you lose the sense of self. You lose the sense of time. And there's a feeling of unity or unification with the partner, or even unity or oneness with everything. So you lose even contact with the partner to some extent in the happy cases. And I think therefore, in particular, this sexual orgasm is so addictive because there's loss of ego, sensation of the ego, exactly as it is in meditation. However, meditation, you don't need to copulate somebody else to feel egoless doing meditation or outside meditation. So Why bother with this monkey business if the egolessness of meditation is as good, if the oneness, the unity, the feeling of being completely emancipated, completely freed from body and mind altogether, if that can be found by another way, then I think it's a better way, both from seen from personal perspective and seen also on a global scale. However, that said, if one is going for this particular egolessness and realize that this is one is going, so often one is subconscious about it. One doesn't know that orgasm contains these elements of no self, anatta, of egolessness and substancelessness and unity and oneness, which is beautiful, advantageous aspects, then orgasm can have some side effects, but usually they are overshadowed by this addiction to sense pleasure, which is, because it's an addiction, because it leads to bondage, that you cannot say no, basically. You can't be seduced. Then this bondage has to be weighed up against this even conscious, deliberate seeking selflessness, oneness, and unity, which is better done on the meditation pillow, because there is no side effects of partner, couple, spouse problems, economical problems, pregnancy, and long-term children, responsibility, or that kind of bondage, where you are bounded to the consequences that comes as side effects, unseen and unwanted in some cases, side effects of addiction to sense pleasure by sex. So there's two sides of all coins. And this also goes for the oneness and unity you can feel during orgasm compared with the oneness and unity you can feel during meditation. The latter one is definitely better because this has less side effects. And you're not dependent on a partner. You can do it for yourself on the pillow. I won't say it's easy, but it's much more lasting and deeper and also more pleasant. Much, 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 much more. So much for this. What future probabilities can it produce? This means what destinations are possible from this sexual behavior? Yeah, if it's done completely harmlessness, in complete harmlessness, effectively towards other partners, then there is the highest level that you have, that where there still is copulation, where there still is some kind of sexual contact. And this is level 11. And we are level 5. And if it's on a complete other scale, where you are raping others or causing others harm by having multiple partners or illicit partners or sidekicks or transmission of deadly diseases, sexual transmitted diseases, well, then it's barbecue. It's hell, basically. So the future destinies from sexual behavior is, in the ideal case, level 11, and we are level 5. And in the absolute detrimental extreme, is hell. Barbecue, screaming like a pig for centuries, if not millennia. So you have there you have it. These are the destinies. I hope this answers the question thoroughly. Then we can go on to question number 89. This is also a very popular question. Can psychedelics improve meditation, understanding, and spirituality? And the answer is a sounding, besides many believe the opposite, no, it cannot. It cannot. Again, because the side effects overshadow the possible effects. And that's the effects, again, that you're seeing that the reality is not, because of this distortion of perception during intoxicated mental states, then one sees that this reality is something else than anticipated. And this this can be a positive effect. If you see something very beautiful, for example, unity with cosmos, oneness with all, then it can be lead into a spiritual path. But it can by no means be a spiritual practice by itself. And that is evidenced by the American church, which take peyote, is basically the Indians. You see their Tipitaka, their tent symbol here. They meet once a week and take peyote, which is a top of a cactus that has psilocybin or LSD-like effects. And none of them are enlightened. They have been taking this for 8,000 years. So it's probably not very not very detrimental either. But it doesn't lead towards enlightenment, and it cannot induce nobility. Only within the early Buddhist tradition is found nobles. And only a type 1 noble, a stream intra, is free from downfall. That is to say, they are free from a future destiny of animal rebirth, hungry ghost, angry demon, and hell rebirth. So they are free of downfall. They are free of the fearful state, abhaya. And that's the sole job of any Buddhist, that is to drag free of that. Because that is almost impossible to come back from. Not fully impossible, but almost impossible. And here you can search for the simile of the blind turtle. There's a whole video about it. The simile of the blind turtle, to see how difficult it is to come back when have fallen down. So this means that even if it doesn't kill you, LSD, psychedelics, marijuana, arak, which is or alcohol, which also has mild psychedelic effects, ecstasy, or all of the mountain of new LSD variants or methamphetamine variants, like ecstasy, they make you nuts because they cause a syndrome for a considerable number of persons that is a hallucinogen persisting perception disorder, is called, where one is seeing funny things, one is seeing granular air, one has impaired driving, one see halos around or auras surrounding objects, one see objects as if they were moving then when they're standing still, even outside of the intoxication. So it's a kind of flashback which is known from LSD, that you get flashbacks of the bad trips suddenly in reality. This means that there is a disorder, a personality disorder, in mild degree or in gross degree, where it goes into complete madness, where one is disengaging from reality. Instead of seeing reality as it is, then one's illusion grow. So during intoxicated mental states, then the illusion grow. Spiritual practice does not have as a purpose to make the illusion grow. It has as a purpose to make the illusion fall. Huh? And this definitely, it does not do. So when people argue that it does anyway, that you see some kind of reality, absolute reality, during the intoxicated mental state, then it is usual because they are addicted to the pleasures of this intoxicated mental state. They're running around in the forest of funny perceptions, phony phantasms, which they ascribe reality, even though they know they have seen something in the same intoxicated mental states that were absolute not reality when they came out of the intoxicated mental states. Then they could see. There's just been an accident in Denmark where one young man who came home from a party where he was taking ecstasy, he was found hanging out from a high tower because he thought he could fly. It was only because he stumbled and then didn't fall down that he survived. Otherwise, he will have jumped out like this and then finished. Because he thought he could fly. And this shows something about it. This, of course, is a rarity. There's not many deaths about it. I'll show some data. All these drugs, which we call hallucinogens, that is to say, LSD and to marijuana to a less degree, psilocybin, methamphetamine, that is ecstasy, and variants of that. They have few deaths and also a few hospitalizations. You can see it here. It's around 100 deaths per country per year, but still it's not without risk either. The major killer is cigarettes and alcohol. When we are with it, there is, I look at the numbers today, in USA there's 90,000 deaths every year. 90,000 deaths. It's much more than that killed soldiers in any war. And globally, it's 3.3 million every year that dies from alcohol-related death. 3.3 million. That's almost Denmark's population that dies every year from alcohol. You know, looking at this from a Buddhist point of view, or from a legislator's point of view, it's absurd that it's not criminal to serve alcohol. not even to minors. 3.3 million deaths every year. How can this be legal? How can this possibly be legal, this alcohol? This is only because the legislators and the politicians and those who vote for them, they are also addicted to alcohol. That's why. There will be no country accepted if they killed. Everyone will go to war against them if they killed 3.3 million every year. Everyone on the planet Earth will do that. Immediately. All will say, now we have to. This enemy has to be defeated. Immediately, because it kills 3.3 million every year. Yes, but so does alcohol. So does alcohol. And that's why all these drugs which cause carelessness and neglect, forgetfulness, lack of abilities, they are clearly breaking the five precepts. And that's why it's really good to put the foot down there and say, no, this is not allowed. If you want to be Buddhist, you have to be clean as a whistle. Come clean, friends. Come clean. It's so beautiful and easy and smiling, like a smiling mountain. All these drugs is running around in circles. And the same with booze. Chemical calm is not real. It is just that, chemical calm. And the side effects is mounting. And when all abusers say, neglect the side effects, I say, they're not really there, and blah, 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 blah. Yes, but if you lose, if you come down to 70% or 80% of what you could do, this any author, any cook, any sport person is then fair, come down to the normal level. So just if you lose the top, you still lose basically your whole career as an artist or as a professional person. Because you act badly. You cannot learn anything new. You cannot remember what you have learned. Because these intoxicated mental states, they are hangovers. Both from booze, but also from marijuana. Marijuana stays in the brain for 3 months before you're free of it. 3 months. And the same goes also with flashbacks and these perception disorders. Mild or gross from ecstasy or LSD or peyote or psilocybin or whatever it might be. So it's clearly a no-go. Nobody becomes holy by increasing the delusion, increasing the illusions, increasing and distorting the perceptions even further. This also goes if you have funny experiences. I get a lot of questions about this from people who are clean and who are meditating. They also experience funny things. Experience a volcano or a galaxy or an ant or an atom or similar things. And this is just when you start meditating, then all these boiling the pot spillovers, they bubble up, but they have no significance. They're very captivating and very colorful. Yes, indeed so. But they are just only that. They are bubbling overs of a monkey mind that is approaching stillness. When you're still the mind, they cease. They cease altogether. Then comes the job with ceasing the rest of this conceptual thinking. And that's a major job. That's a major job. But a very, very nice job, worth the effort, because this stillness is inexpressible. The peace connected with not thinking, without vichara and vichakka, is exquisite. It's excellent. It's inexpressible. Ineffable. This is second jhana. Ending of perceptual thinking. Nevertheless, you cannot anesthetize your way to nibbana and not even approach. You cannot intoxicate or take a helicopter on hallucinogens up to the top and see how there is, or see whether it's worth the effort. it's all blah, blah, blah. No. There is no free lunch. There is no new age funny bunny. No, there's not. If there were, then all these 60s hippies, they were enlightened or had special abilities, but they don't. They are just flat post hippies, which you can see all over the place. Now they are becoming fat and old, and they're not very clever usually, because they have lost a youth usually on drugs. And also this American Indian church, there's no one found there to be special. They just take drugs and think it's divine. They come into contact with something that is divine. That's not the case. It's illusions. Captivating conceptual illusions, but nothing more than that. So, this dependency, addiction, and then this paranoia that comes afterwards because of misevaluating situations, this disconnectedness from reality, this produces more illusion and not less illusion. So, this mystical, physical experiencing is like watching cartoons with the mind. And I think it goes without saying that early Buddhism, Theravada Buddhism, they stand by that point. As soon as you go straight into Mahayana and say, maybe it can be good. Maybe it can be skillful means. Bullshit. Bullshit. It's not a skillful mean. It's a way down. You're pulling out. You're pulling back to sense pleasure. Sense pleasure by an intoxicated mental state. An addiction to that. It's not a skillful mean. Why not? Because basically, when you say it's okay for a Buddhist to take drugs, then there are a lot of people who could be good Buddhists. They say, okay, it's okay to drink and take drugs. We can't be good Buddhists, even though we know it's breaking the fifth precepts. But if it's skillful means, if we're good to ourselves, or we have good to others, if it's advantageous to others, but how can it be advantageous to others or to yourself when it ruins the show? When it's caused more illusion, more delusion, more ignorance, more blindness, more running around in the endless forest of phantasms, various mental constructions that are not real in the ultimate sense. What you see during this intoxicated mental state is not ultimate reality, by no means. And this also, everyone who is usually have tried this intoxicated mental states, whether from hallucinogens or from booze or from marijuana, when you come back then and look back, if you can remember anything at all, huh? Because memory, from short-term to long-term memory, this is almost completely cut. So you cannot learn anything during the intoxicated mental states. So if you can remember anything the next day, then it's definitely not the same thing if you go out and re-perceive the same object the next day. These musicians know when they play music, it sounds very good, but if they play what they recorded in the intoxicated mental state, it doesn't sound good. It's not tight. It's not accurate. It's waving around in the mud. Then there's these flashbacks. So they cannot bypass any real pure spiritual practice. So purity is a must. This moral responsibility, this ethical behavior, this sila is the lifeblood of the Sangha, of the spiritual practice that leads to nobility, which is the only safe haven from downfall at the moment of death. Only safe haven. And that's only if you reach Sotapanna level, stream entry level, stream winner level. And that's also difficult. Even without drugs. Even without alcohol. That's only the basics. Huh? That's only the basics. So this sila, this morality of the five precepts, it has to be there. It's a foundation of any spiritual practice that is serious and that thereby is effective. So it hereby is a matter of efficacy. You ruin the efficacy. And thereby also any progress, and thereby any target, dreaming about any targets is completely illusory by these psychedelics. In whatever dose, low dose, medium dose, or high dose, only in the weekends or once a month or whatever, or after meditation or not, no, no, drop it. Get rid of it, eradicate it, throw it out. It's useless. It's more than useless because it degrade and abrogate, pollute and dilute any spiritual praxis. So you cannot kind of come to see absolute reality by perfuming it or by anesthesia. The mind, the Buddha was very clear about it. If you want to have a perfect mind, then you should train and develop the mind just as it is. Not under influence of any drug. Not even under influence of any emotion. Of any like or dislike. Just as it is. Right on. This cool equanimity then takes its stance. And when equanimity, upekkha, takes its stance, then the real, absolute reality lies there, right in front of the mind. Right there, just there. Not skewed, not veiled, not obscured, not polluted. One can ask oneself whether to come to see a sandwich like this one, like this grainy thing with small eyes, whether this can lead to nibbana or awakening or any absolute truth. This is obviously not the case. This is an illusion. Huh? There's eyes in small, eyes inside, and it starts crawling. That's a typical perception, distorted perception, psychedelics will give. Seeing the sandwich like this strange, warped, animal-like thing does not lead to seeing reality just as it is. It leads to delusion going sky high. Because of hallucinations, either partial or complete. Whether you know it or not, whether they're hallucinations, you know it's hallucinations or not, doesn't matter. It's still hallucination. So it's not from cranking up the number of hallucinations, or delusions, or pollutions, or fermentations, that one becomes enlightened or awakened from the illusion. Awakened bodhi actually means to wake up to reality from this illusory delusion. Then one obviously not approach that state, that's completely clear state, by cranking up all kinds of intoxicated pollutions caused by psychedelics.
I did a video on drugs, right? Meditating on drugs. But I think I didn't answer the question sufficiently. The question is, I know that drugs are forbidden in Buddhist practice, but can they bring some form of clarity and understanding? Psychedelic drugs are said to break down barriers and bring an understanding of the world. Now, I happen to have done psychedelic drugs before, and if you haven't done psychedelic drugs, here's the sort of experiences that I had. Lying on the on my back in a field and looking up at the sky and saying, the sky, the heavens is my father, and down at the earth, and the earth was my mother, and they were fighting over me. And it was they weren't like killing each other over me, but they were, it was a struggle who was going to get me, because here I was lying on the earth in between them both, and you know, so on and so on. And it was just like this profound feeling. The point I'm getting at is, I'd question whether it actually brings clarity and understanding about the world. another experience, I had all these gods coming in and using me. You know, one at a time they would come in. There was the god with the Viking hat, you know, and there were all sorts of gods coming in, and they were using my body. Like, they would control me and they had power over me. I was sitting in my room alone, and I was like, "Oh, I hope they know what they're doing." I would suggest that experimenting with psychedelic drugs, because of their ability only to change the state of the brain and to not free one totally from the filter of the brain or the constraints of the brain, they on the other hand simply change the state of awareness. I would say it's highly dubious as to whether this is going to lead to true wisdom, because it has just as much potential to mess you up. The last time I did mushrooms, it really messed up my mind, and Nagasena was confirming it, that the same thing happened to him. You feel like your mind becomes disjoined from reality. There's like a gap. It's like a scar in your brain that keeps you back from reality. Like, you see everything going on still, but you're less connected to it.
I don't have experience on my own with those kind of drugs, other than as an observer of other people who took it. I remember that a long time ago I was directing a theater piece, and two of the actors came to the rehearsal under the influence of drugs. And they stood there on the scene, and they thought they are so brilliant. And they stood there like giggling idiots. I can't find better descriptions. Really, there was nothing going on. They were not able to act or to remember anything clearly. Everything that we had done so far in rehearsals was even lost. And they thought it's really great what they are doing. So and that was just a misperception. And I think that is what is happening when you are under drugs. You have some perceptions, but it's not the perception of reality as it really is. It is reality under the influence of drugs. Mm. And that's not the truth. That's not the reality.
And so, yeah, for sure, what you gain in meditation is objective and empirically far beyond what you gain from drugs.
I think that so much goes for psychedelics and alcohol. Again, 3 million deaths for alcohol. And the rest is down the drain, even though you don't die. So keep the 5 precepts, which is goes like this. I hereby accept the training rule of avoidance of all alcohol-containing drinks and all drugs that cause carelessness and neglect. And this all drugs do. Whether excitation, whether it's from cocaine, or on the other side, dullness or sleepiness from marijuana. You forget your family, your job, what you have learned yesterday, yourself, the future, everything. Either incompletely or completely. Forgetfulness is not a part of Buddhist virtues. Not at all. Actually, it is not mindfulness, not awareness, sati ne, anti-sati, it is. Let's go on to a question. The last question is question 190. What is the Buddhist view on organ donation? Very, very positive, actually, if it's performed. Of course, if you take organs out of prisoners, as has been done in China, and from poor people, as has been done in India, and sell them for high price on the international organ market, then it's another issue. If it's forced, then of course it's theft. If it's only luring in people with a low money price and then selling it for 100 times more, then it's kind of like more like fraud. But in the case of one person who deliberately, and there are many monks who do that actually, usually a kidney, that gives their kidney or can be a liver lobe to another person who is in distress because of this lack of this organ, then it is reckoned as something that close to perfection of the first mental perfection, of which there is 10. The first one is generosity, dana, parami. And this can be perfected to 3 degrees. The first degree is to give away all one's possessions, house, car, money, children, a wife, everything, clothes, everything gives away. This is the first perfection. The second perfection, and this is to give an organ or a limb. The first perfection leads to the beings to Savakkabodhi, that is to enlightenment as a disciple of a Buddha. This means that Savakkabodhi, you cannot attain enlightenment yourself. You have to have a teacher that is enlightened. Or, yes, a teacher that's enlightened. Doesn't it need to be a Buddha? It can be another Savakkabodhi that has attained enlightenment. But you need to have a teacher up to nobility, up to attaining stream entry. Then you need no need, no teacher. Then you're independent the rest of the way. But nevertheless, this organ donation then counts as the second degree of perfection of generosity. And that's the Pacceka-Buddhas, the solitary Buddhas that does not teach unless you ask them. At one time there was more than 500 here on planet Earth. There's been one since Buddha Gautama. We don't know who it was or where he or she was. We know there's been one. The rhinoceros horn, which is a poem collection, is from all these, what these Pacceka-Buddhas say. So they say something, they teach something. They are next only to the Sammasambuddha. So they are perfectly self-enlightened. That is, enlightened without a teacher. But they have not attained perfection in all their abilities. This is to say that they don't know, that they do not have the dasa, bala, that they can evaluate other beings' abilities perfectly. So they don't have all the attainments. That's what Sammasambuddha can do. He can immediately, by evaluating another being, see whether this being can attain enlightenment in this life, and when, and if they will, whether they will succeed or not. And he can also see whatever, if you do something, A or B or C or D, then he can see the destination for whatever action it is. So he has a complete view of cause and effect, of karma and fruit of karma. This he has complete view over. This the Pacceka-Buddhas doesn't have. But they're very, very close, very, very close. They usually live alone, but there can be more than one present on planet Earth at a time. They come when there are no Buddhas, in between the Buddhas. There are many stories about them in the text. There is a whole study of them by Ria Kloppenborg. I will show the link below on Pacceka-Buddhas, and I also have some pages on it on my website, whatbuddhasaid.net. Just search for solitary Buddha. So, in the good case, altruistic, non-egoistic organ donation, then it's very, very, very positive. Very, very, very positive. It only goes short of one, that is giving your own life that way, deliberately, as the Buddha did several times in his career. He gave himself to a pregnant tiger, and he gave himself to a wandering priest when he was a hare. When he gave himself to a pregnant tiger, then he was a human. So organ donation comes very close to ultimate perfection. Very close. Not up there, but very, very close as you come. As close as you come. For the dana parami, the perfection, the mental perfection of generosity. This reminds me of saying that actually, because now it's raining so much, and you can see here my meditators, when they come in, are more than three, and they have to sit, then they have to sit outside in the rain, on the porch, and therefore I'm building a meditation hall, a small, it's just a cover, a roof basically, an open roof, so we can have access to the jungle from all sides. And if you want to support this, and thereby support other beings, approach to Nibbana, and thereby gaining ease of access to Nibbana yourself, then you can donate to this noble purpose. Just click donate button on my website, whatbuddhasaid.net, or send me an email, and then I can send you some bank accounts, either in Europe or here in Sri Lanka, to transfer some funds for this noble project. Just send me an email and earmark it, Dhammasala or Meditation Hall, also on the funds you send, then they will go strictly to this purpose. Thank you for your attention, patience, and consideration. So here you see, here's where the meditators sit when there are more than two. They sit on this one, but because this isn't full undercover, then it's weather like this, gray weather or rainy weather, then it's wet here. So it's not a very suitable place to sit. And during monsoon, it will often be wet like this weather is today. Let's go in and see where the meditation hall will be.